Yeah, as we've just learned, we can also implement multilayer perceptrons for regression. So let's actually do it and see how it works out in practice. And as usual, we will start with the data set. Yeah, just to keep things simple, we will have a toy data set where we only have one feature variable. That's just so that we can plot and visualize the results, similar to what we have seen on the slides. It's really just for visual purposes. However, of course, the multilayer perceptron for regression is not restricted to one-dimensional datasets. But again, so having a one-dimensional dataset here lets us plot the input feature versus the output feature, the target variable. And as we can see, this is how it looks like. So we have the feature variable on the x-axis and the target variable on the y-axis. And our goal, of course, is to have a model that, given the input feature, can predict the target. So let's implement our multilayer perceptron. Yeah, notice that this is exactly the same code that we used before. So there is no change. We still have our three layers, the first hidden layer, second hidden layer, and the output layer. It's exactly the same code that we used for the XOR or the MNIST dataset, except now that the output is here 1 because we only have one target variable. Then, like we discussed before, it's usually a good idea to normalize the data. So for the XOR dataset, we didn't bother about it too much because the data was already centered at 0 and consisted of small values. And for the MNIST dataset, we had pixel values that were automatically normalized to the 0-1 range via the torch 2 tensor method. So we previously used 2 tensor in the data augmentation or transform pipeline, which already normalized the images. Here we are doing it explicitly using standardization, and that is because you can see the values are very large here, and you can get better convergence during training if you have standardized or normalized features. All right, then let's define our dataset class here. And this dataset class is much simpler compared to the dataset classes we talked about in the context of MNIST. In fact, what we are doing here is, because it's a simple dataset where we only have 2 arrays, we are just copying over the arrays, or we're just saving them via attributes here so that we can access them in our getItem method. Remember, the getItem method will return a single training example label pair via index. So this is a single data point, a single feature value, and this is a single label. And yeah, then we are defining our data loader using this training data set where we have a batch size of 20, and we are of course shuffling it. So next we can define our training loop. Again, the code is almost identical to what we have done before. So we are first again initializing our multilayer perceptron. Here we only have one input feature. We say we want to train it for 30 epochs using stochastic gradient descent. And then we are iterating over the epochs. And here we are iterating over the mini batches, just like before. And then in this portion, we are also exactly like before computing the gradients, except with this one little change that we are now using the MSE loss function instead of the cross entropy function. But except that, everything is the same. All right, let's start the training and see what the results are. And yeah, as we can see, it's training pretty quickly. The loss goes down pretty fast until it's almost 0. All right, let's now plot the regression fit. So what we are going to do is we are going to predict the target values for the x range, for the input range between 150 and 800, so that we get a smooth line. If I go back up again, we have here values between, let's say, 250 and 600. So what we technically need to do is we have to predict for the different values here in between what the target would be. So in order to have a nice regression line here, or more like a curve. So for that, we are going to predict the target values for the x values in this range here. However, since our model was trained on standardized data, we also have to standardize this new data. So we can pretend that this is new data here, x range is new data, and we have to normalize that. So for the normalization, we do it the same way we did it before. We use the training set standard deviation and the training set mean to normalize this data here. Then once we have it normalized, we we can call the forward method of the model here. So the forward method is not shown because it's implicit, but this will obtain the predictions for this normalized X range. Notice that we are again using this no grad context. This is exactly or almost exactly the same as using inference. It does not really matter which one you use. Inference is a little bit newer. No grad is the older way of doing that. Both ways work perfectly fine. Okay, so there's one more normalization challenge here, and that is that previously we normalized also our training targets. So the targets were normalized as well, which means that the model will predict normalized target values, because that's exactly the same thing that it was doing during training. So it's usually a good idea to normalize the targets so that the mean squared error is on a reasonable range here, so that you can make, for example, even comparisons across data sets, so that you don't have really super large MSE values. However, that means that the model here returns normalized targets. So what we have to do in order to plot the predictions in the plot, we have to undo this normalization. So what we are doing now is we are unnormalizing the target variable that is returned or predicted by the model. So in order to do that, we perform exactly the opposite of standardization. So instead of minus mean, we say plus the mean. And instead of dividing by the standard deviation, we are multiplying by the standard deviation. So here we are doing the inverse of standardization to obtain the unnormalized prediction values. And I just noticed I made a little mistake. This should be not no inference. I was thinking of no grad, which works. Or what I was thinking about was inference mode. So this was the correct one. All right, so now that we have these unnormalized targets, we can actually plot the predictions. So we are going to plot the training set just for reference, and then we are plotting the X range and the unnormalized prediction scores so that we can show them together with the unnormalized training data points. And as we can see here, the regression model fits the data quite well. I would say it's even not overfitting here because it's not overly curvy here. It's actually a really nice regression fit. Yeah, in this notebook, we learned how we can implement multilayer perceptrons for regression problems. Of course, when working with regression problems, it's always a good idea to analyze the results to make sure that the multilayer perceptron is not overfitting. However, if you use multilayer perceptrons for regression in practice, always make sure that you are not overfitting to the data. Whether you want to use multilayer perceptrons for regression, that's up to you, but here at least now you know how it works.